WebSawJS. Hi again, everybody. Thank you all for being here. My name is Amit, and today we're going to see how to use the user's mouse position to manipulate and control our CSS with CSS. Yes, you can do it with JavaScript. What we're going to see today is a pure CSS alternative, just because it's a nice trick and something that might be useful in the future. So just before we begin, I'm going to do a quick introduction. As I said, my name is Amit Chin. I'm a web developer. Been writing code since forever. I'm doing it professionally most of my adult life, mainly front-end, a lot of CSS. I really like to push the limits of CSS, and I love learning new things. So if you've got anything interesting, everything front-end related, talk to me on Twitter or something. So let's begin. I'm actually going to start with some examples, just so you can see it in action. So when I'm talking about mapping, I'm talking about using the user's mouse position, to set our CSS property. Here, for example, I've created this trail of dots following the cursor. The animation is obviously with CSS, and I'm actually mapping here the mouse position to set the top and left properties of the dot. You can control any property you like. Here, for example, I'm mapping the mouse position to the transform rotate X and rotate Y. And you can also set the colors, the color sizes, positions, anything you want. This is an example of a nice parallax effect using background position. I'm setting the background position. And this is just an example to demonstrate that you can even control the content of an element just by mapping the mouse position. Again, everything is with pure CSS. So how does it work? In a second, we're going to do some live coding. We're going to do it live. Here's what we're going to do. So first, we're going to build a grid on the screen. And then we're going to use the hover pseudo class. Every time the users hover over a cell, we're going to set two variables. So for example, when I'm hovering this cell, the X is equals one because it's one cell over, and Y equals two. If I'm going to hover the cell next to it, X is going to be equals two. If I'm hover the cell beneath it, then Y X will equals three, and so on. And then the last thing that we're going to do is to use these variables to set our CSS property. It could be, again, any property that we want. So let's do some live coding. Again, let's go to our browser. And we're going to use this cube. I'm not going to talk about the cube itself. If you're interested, I wrote a whole full article about CSS perspective. This is the article. How CSS perspective works, with lots of example and a step-by-step guide to building this cube with animations and everything you need. So I'm not going to talk about the cube itself, but let's have a quick look on our markup. We have a wrapper div with the class of content, and we have the cube itself with six sides. Let's take a look at the CSS. The CSS has nothing special yet, just the body, the content, and the cube. And we can see that the cube has an animation right now, obviously, but we're going to stop this animation. I'm going to comment it out. Yep. Because we want to control the cube's rotation with the mouse movement. And we'll do it by mapping the mouse position to the cube's rotate X and rotate Y. And actually, let's add here at the content to custom property. Let's add position X and position Y. These will be our variables to set. So let's begin. And we've said that the first thing, the first step will be to build a grid. Now we're going to do a simple 10 by 10 grid, but you can do the grid in any size you want. The more cells you have, the more accurate the mapping will be. But a lot of cells can also lead to performance issues. So adjust the grid size according to your specific needs. But again, we'll use a simple 10 by 10 grid, which means I need to add 100 cells to my markup. And I have to add these cells before the content, like here. And why? Because of the cascade. The way the cascade works, the way CSS works, we want to use this cell to control this content. And you can only control, each element can only control its descendants or their following siblings, meaning siblings that comes after the element. So the cells must come before this content, and I can't actually put the cells inside their own div. So the cells have to be before the content. So let's add cell times 100, that's 100 cells, press tab, and here we have 100 cells just before the content. Let's go to our CSS and add a cell class. We'll give them a width of 10% and the height. And just so we can see them, let's give them a border of 1 pixel solid white. Okay. It's supposed to be. Yeah. So here, yeah. That's the way it's supposed to be. So this is our cells, but obviously that's not the way they're supposed to be. We want them to be in a grid. And there's a few ways that we can position these cells. We can use position absolute and use top left or transition. But the easiest option by far is just to use a display grid. So let's get back to our body and give our body a display of grid. And because we want the grid to be a 10 by 10, we'll give it a grid template, right? This is 10 by 10. Okay, now these cells have to be 100%. And just for visualization purposes, we're gonna add this hover effect. So let's add a background of, green. So here we have a full size grid, 10 by 10. And when I hover over the cells, they turn green. So the second step is to map these cells, each cell, to a custom property, to this custom property that we set earlier. So we need to target each cell. And that's not a problem. We can target a cell by using the nth child selector. For example, let's take this cell, for example. I know that this is cell number 13, because this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13. So this cell is number 13. So if I want to target him, I can come right over here and select cell nth child 13, and then right here inside I can set these two custom property. The x here is equals to 2 and y equals to 1. Okay, So, but it's okay. But there's actually two things. I actually only want to set these values when the user hovers over the cell. So we're going to give this cell also the hover pseudo class. And the second thing is we don't want to set the custom properties of the cell itself. We want to set these values to its sibling, to the content div. So we're going to actually add a sibling combinator. This sign over here is the sibling combinator, and select the content. So now actually it works. So when I hover over this specific cell, the custom property changes to these values. This custom property changes to these values. And we'll see it in action in 2 minutes. Right now we don't see anything changes. But first I need to do this part 100 times for 100 cells, right? Now I can theoretically copy this 100 times and change and change the values each time, but I'm obviously not going to do it. There are a few ways to make things simpler, like you can target a whole row or a whole column, for example, and that makes things easier instead of targeting just one cell at a time. And I actually wrote about this method, about the column method in my article, but for now, because we don't have enough, a lot of time, so we're just going to use a simple and fast for loop, okay? So I'm going to use for, let's take a variable, and we're going to use it 100 times, so from 0 to 100, okay? And this is the cell, and let's just do a very simple math here. This needs to be the I one, and so I select each cell every time that I loop, and the X position needs to be dollar I, the remaining of 10, and this needs to be floor, so that's it actually. And now when I hover over the screen for each cell, the mouse position is mapped into these custom properties. So the last thing that we need to do is to actually use this custom property and to see the change happen live. So let's go to our cube. Okay, we commented out this animation. Let's go to our cube and have a transform. Rotate Y, let's start with the Y axis. And we'll do a calc here. So I want the rotation, the initial rotation to be minus 180 degrees, and I want the final rotation, the final to be plus 100 degrees. So that's minus 100 degrees plus 20 degrees for each step. So I'm actually going to write it here, calc. Okay, I said minus 180 degrees plus 20 degrees times it's each step for the X position, because the X, when I move on the X axis, the cube rotates around the Y axis. So this is var position X. So now when I hover over the screen, when I go from left to right, you can see the cube rotates. You know, let's get rid of the border for now. Yeah. So when I move the mouse from left to right, you can see the cube moves from left to right. So let's just copy it real quick for the Y axis also. So the rotate X is for the position, of the Y. So now we can see that we have a full 360 view of the cube. We're using remapping the mouse position and everything, of course, with pure CSS. And that's it. This is how you map and use mouse position with CSS. I actually wanted, there is one last example I wanted to show you. I did a longer live session with our local CSS community, where I actually took this a step further and built kind of a click and drag effect. So when I hover over this this cube, nothing happened. But when I click, I can actually like grab it and start dragging it. So when I leave the mouse, the animation gets back, and when I click it, I can drag it. So this is just one more idea of what you can do with it. Yeah, I think I tried to make it faster. Yeah, that's it for me. Questions?
So I'm back, and congratulations for the great talk. And yeah, super interesting, especially that you showed us also the coding experience and how you use this CodePen tool. And thanks a lot for that. So Jejuch asks you, from your experience, what is the maximum grid size that is still effective on most devices?
Well, here's the thing. First of all, this method is mainly for desktops. If you want to, I didn't talk about mobiles. I want to make this lecture a bit shorter. But if you want to use mobile, so you have to use Focus, or you would have to use JavaScript. So if you are talking about desktops, so I think you can go up to several hundreds divs without having too much to worry about, because you're not animating the divs, you're not actually doing anything with them, they're statics. So I have in my examples, I'm using 20 and 20 grids, so it's 400 cells, and there is no lag, like it's pretty smooth.